Thank you very much, and thank you for being here. I'll give you a little background on myself. When I was going to school, I worked in the summer construction to help pay for tuition, so on and so forth. And after I got done with school, I realized I liked breaking things and digging dirt and all that more than I enjoyed getting dressed up and sitting down at a desk. So I ended up doing a lot of construction over the years. However, by the time I hit 40, my body was telling me, you can't do this anymore. You can only fall off so many roofs before it starts coming back on you. So right about that time, a friend of mine with the University of Minnesota Extension Service, Ken Olson, told me that the university was really starting to focus on educational programs, and he said, we need help. Would you like to get involved? So I did. One of the things that Ken did, he realized that virtually 100% of all the educational programs were focused on the contractors, teaching them the proper way to design septic systems, how to install them, and how to maintain them. No one was addressing the homeowners on how they should be using those systems. So he began a program. It was a pilot program of teaching homeowners, and of course everybody laughed, yeah, right, homeowners don't care, no one's going to show up. Well, it blew everybody's socks off because he'd end up with 30, 40, 50 people, 100 people at these meetings, of which everybody told him no one's going to show up. Well, people were showing up. And he also did some follow-up studies on it, and he found out that virtually 100% of the people that attended these sessions made some kind of adjustment in their lifestyle to take care of their septic systems. Common statement was, this is simple. Why didn't somebody teach me this before? So I started doing that. Now occasionally I would get a call from people that would say, hey, the nearby city wants to run the sewer mains out to us. Can you show us how to shut them down? And of course I really didn't think much of it at that time, just that people didn't want to spend the money to get hooked up, you know, they were cheap, whatever. But then I started hearing more and more horror stories from property owners on what it really cost and the damage it was doing. That was when I threw a hardcore study on it, and I found out, yeah, there's some pretty nasty things that go along with it. So now when people call, and that's what most of the calls that I get now is from people that are saying, hey, we want to shut down a sewage treatment facility or an expansion. We want to try and shut it down. And that's what I'm dealing with primarily now. See, water is not just what we drink. It's for entertainment, fishing, water skiing, going to the beach. Water is critical to every aspect of our life, and we need to start taking care of it. And unfortunately, in this country, we've been used to cheap and easy water, and it has been up to this point. But that is changing. And you're going to see that here in something coming up here. Now, water, just to let people know, is just in a big cycle. That's all it is. Water evaporates up, comes down in the form of rain and snow. It recharges our lakes and our rivers. Some of it goes down through the soil, feeds the shallow water tables, and some of it continues down further and feeds the deeper aquifers. And that's all it is. Just in a big cycle, keeps going around and around like that. But we're interfering in that cycle. A lot of it has to do with overdevelopment. If you notice how when the water comes down, the rain comes down, all right, that's on open ground. What happens when you clear a field, put in roads, start building homes? All right, you've got those roofs. They shed the water. It goes down the driveway, down into the road, which is now becomes a man-made riverbed and gets flushed down to usually a storm sewer system that goes to a river that goes down to the ocean somewhere. All right? We're starting to interfere with that process. There's not as much water going down in the ground as it used to be. But the developers get their stuff done.
If there's one thing most Americans take for granted, it's water. It covers more than two-thirds of the earth, but did you know less than 1% of it is usable? People can survive only about 3 days without water. Yet in 15 years, nearly 2 billion people around the world will be living in areas where it's scarce. Even in this country, sources of water are drying up. And in some places, Mark Strassman tells us they're already fighting over it as CBS reports where America stands.
Americans are the world's biggest water consumers. By 9 a.m., after showering, using the bathroom, brushing our teeth, and having a cup of coffee, each of us typically has used more than 30 gallons of water. After doing the dishes, running the washing machine, and watering the lawn, by the time we go to bed, we've used up to 150 gallons. By comparison, people in the UK use a quarter of that, 40 gallons of water a day. The Chinese average just 22 gallons per day. And in the poorest countries, like Kenya, people use less than the minimum 13 gallons to cover basic needs. Because Americans use so much, the report card shows water is an emerging crisis here.
Partly rightfully so. I mean,
Steve Solomon is the author of a new book, Water.
Water is overtaking oil as our scarcest natural resource in the world, and even we're going to find it in the United States as well.
Scientists have never measured the exact amount of water available in the U.S., but they're concerned enough that they've just launched a new government study to find out. Experts do agree, demand is greater than supply, and 36 U.S. states face water shortages in the next 3 years. Every day, Arizona and parts of New Mexico use 300 million gallons more than they get in renewable supply. The extra comes from underground supplies, which are not renewable. How much water's underground and when could it run out? No one knows. And clearly that's a problem. Nowhere is America's water crisis more evident than Lake Mead, just outside Las Vegas. The city has 2 million thirsty people and gets 90% of its drinking water from the lake. This area has grappled with a decade of drought. All last year, it rained 2 inches, half its normal total.
If you stripped it all away.
Pat Mulroy heads the Southern Nevada Water Authority.
As the driest city in the United States, it is definitely at the crisis level.
When full, Lake Mead could cover all of Pennsylvania under a foot of water. But since 1998, the lake's capacity has plunged more than half, down 5.6 trillion gallons, enough to supply the entire United States for about 6 months.
See that white band on the canyon walls? Locals call it the bathtub ring. It's mineral residue left behind by Lake Mead's sinking water, and it's more than 130 feet high all around the lake. A reminder to everyone here how deep their water problem really is.
Who would ever thought that it would go down this slope?
Gail Kaiser's family has owned a marina here since 1957. But in 2002, water levels were so low, the marina's docks were landlocked.
It was a wake-up call because, you know, we've been here for a long time and you don't think those things are going to happen.
Kaiser showed me their old, original water line.
This old one is up by the green tank right up here.
This green tank, 1,000 feet from the water's new edge.
If you look at your navigational GPS in your car, you're standing in the water.
Since then, they've moved 15 more times. And later this month, the marina will have to move again. 4 miles from the marina, the Hoover Dam supplies hydroelectric power to 2 million homes and businesses in Nevada, Arizona, and California. But without enough water pressure from the lake, these massive generator units will stop turning. As manager here, Ken Rice checks the lake's level every day.
There's a point below which the lake cannot go.
From a power generation standpoint, our main concern would be about an elevation 1050.
The lake's elevation has plunged to 1,095 feet, just 45 feet above the point that worries Rice.
What do we do then? What do we do?
America needs solutions to its water worries. Las Vegas has aggressive water conservation program. 70% of this desert community's water use is outdoors. So the local water authority pays homeowners to rip out their lawn and replace it with desert-friendly landscaping.
Well, that was a huge cultural change.
Yeah, well, they actually had water flowing off of their property.
Las Vegas has also hired water police to patrol and issue fines to water violators. And on the Strip, City Center is the new jewel. $8 billion of environmentally friendly luxury, including low-flow water fixtures, slashing water use more than 100 million gallons a year. And the city's efforts seem to be paying off. From 2002 to 2008, the city boomed. 400,000 more people moved in. But water consumption dropped by 20 billion gallons. Other regions are trying other solutions. Coastal states have built more than 200 desalination plants. By next year, San Diego's new one could convert 50 million gallons of ocean water a day into drinking water. Eight states surrounding the Great Lakes are trying to hold on to what they have. They've signed a pact banning the export of water to outsiders, even other U.S. states.
They're trying to hold on to their water, which they see as a rightfully see as a competitive advantage.
Smart or greedy?
Both.
But water experts agree. Conservation is America's best hope.
Everyone has a piece of the responsibility. It is our individual behaviors.
Behaviors now starting to change, slowly, as Americans learn the real worth of water. Mark Strassman, CBS News, Las Vegas.
It was when I saw it. And of course, then some people are going to say, well, yeah, that's Nevada, that's Arizona, there are deserts out there. Well, no, it's not just there. This is all over the country. Take a look at this map here. You guys are on it. There's 36 states that are closing in on a water crisis shortage. All right? One that really kind of blows a lot of people away is Florida. It wasn't that long ago that the joke was, you want to buy some property in Florida, and it would turn out to be swampland. Well, guess what? Those swamps are disappearing. There are people that bought lake homes 10 years ago. Now the lake's gone. Actually, they're taking so much water out of the ground and putting it downriver to a sewage, from a sewage treatment facility out to either the Gulf or the Atlantic. The state is getting sinkholes. Some of you have probably seen it in the news. Sinkholes, there's, you know, sections of freeway. Well, I know of one home, they had to sit, they shot in like 30 feet of concrete underneath the house to try and prevent it from sinking. But that's what happens with aquifers, groundwater. It actually helps hold up the topsoil. Here's another shocker for you. Parts of Arizona and Nevada have dropped over 15 feet. The ground is actually sunk because they took that water out, and that helps hold it up. So, but yeah, if you look at that map, you guys are right there. Minnesota isn't, but guess what? We're having problems there. Here's something from back in 2002 from the Illinois-Indiana Sea Grant Program, which is a collaboration of colleges and Congress to help protect our shore and coastlines. This right back there, back in 2002, they were saying, hey, we got to start doing something here to start conserving the resource we have, which is water. Milwaukee and Chicago are facing water supply constraints. They're already pumping out of Lake Michigan, and there's a lot of problems with that. But here in Minnesota, and you'll hear me refer to Minnesota on a few different examples, it's not just because I live there, but a lot of people, when somebody mentions Minnesota, what do they think? Cold and water. Well, the cold, yeah, it's kind of blown out of proportion. Northern Minnesota, no, it is cold up there. But central Minnesota, Minneapolis, St. Paul, it's about the same as what it is here as far as cold. Yes, we do get 2, 3, 4 weeks sometimes in the winter where it gets brutally cold, but that's about it. The rest of the time, it's pretty similar to what you have here. What isn't an exaggeration, though, is the amount of water we have. We actually have about 13,000 lakes in our state, but 13 doesn't look good on a license plate number, so we go with the motto, the land of 10,000 lakes. Well, in the Twin Cities area, there's a lake called White Bear, and it's beautiful. It's a suburb of St. Paul, the state capital. Beautiful lake, peninsula, island, all that. It's the place where everybody wants to live. Over the last 10 years, that lake has dropped 5 feet. And the reason is they wanted to develop that area. They wanted more homes and businesses out there. So what did the communities do? They kept building sewage treatment facilities and running the lines out and making people get off their septic systems and hook up to this, and we can put in more homes and we get more taxes coming in. Yes, this is a good thing. Well, there was two students from the University of Minnesota. It was their last year in the engineering department, so they decided to do this as their senior piece. They did a study on it, and they found out that for every inch White Bear Lake dropped, so did the Prairie du Chien Jordan Aquifer underneath the Twin Cities. It sank 2 inches, the lake had sank 2 inches. 3 inches, 3 inches on the lake. And it's not just White Bear Lake, it's several lakes. And there's different types of lakes. There's chains of lakes, and a lot of you are familiar with those. That's the one where a stream comes in at the north end, south end, it goes out to another lake, you know, through a stream. But then you have landlocked lakes, and that's what White Bear is, and several of the other lakes in that area. They're landlocked. They get their feed from the underground water supplies. Well, when those water supplies drop, they aren't getting any more water, and that's why now that the Prairie du Chien has sunk 5 feet, so has White Bear Lake. Kind of an ironic little twist, when these students put this out there, they ran into what they called political snarls. The cities that they were trying to tell this stuff to didn't want to hear it. They like, no, we don't want you coming to our community and stirring people up. Really what it's coming down to is they're saying, hey, we need the development now, we need the dollars now, that's what we need the treatment fees, so we'll do this now, run out of water tomorrow, and then worry about fixing that problem. Now I'm going to give you some history on sewage. May not sound real interesting, but I'll tell you what. I've had health department officials come up to me afterwards and say, you know, I deal with septic systems and sewage. We didn't even know any of this stuff. Plus, it explains to you, the homeowners, how dangerous it can be if you don't do it right. Do you know that sewage has been used as a weapon? When you look at that picture of that castle, a lot of people think of that beautiful moat running around the castle. You know, oh yeah, that looks real picturesque, until you find out what's really in there. It was a defensive weapon. It was sewage. It wasn't goldfish floating in that moat, you know. It kept, if you wanted to storm the castle, you had to go through 6 to 10 feet of raw sewage. Not a pleasant, appealing thought. Also, where do mosquitoes like to breed? Pools of water. Do you know that more people have been killed by mosquitoes from breeding in pools of sewage than all of the people killed in all of the wars from the beginning of time? That's how bad it can be. How America was built. America was built on rivers, and there was a reason for that. See, back in those days, back in the 1700s and 1800s, there wasn't any freeways. There wasn't any railroads. Roads were pretty shabby to begin with. So if you wanted to get anything, get things anywhere, you took it upstream up a river. All right, you barged it up, especially larger things. That's why you will see most cities are built right on a river, because that's where, hey, you know, we used it for transportation. This is a good place. Let's build a city here. They also eventually used it for power. First, they started using it for, grain mills, milling flour, sawmills, all that. See, but there was also something else real critical, drinking water. All right. Back in those days, there wasn't just wells dug all over the place. No, most people used surface water. That's where they got their drinking water supply from. Okay? But they also used it for something else, a place to dump their sewage. See, when the city started building up, well, some of you have probably heard of the term chamber pots. That's what people used. They used a big porcelain chamber pot for a bathroom. And you know what they did with it in the morning? Poured it out the window into the street. It wasn't just manure from animals. It was from people as well. They started realizing this not only was unsanitary, it was also stinky. So what they started doing was running everything underground. Now you had cities like Minneapolis. They would take out water out of the Mississippi River on the north end of it. Then, on the south end of it, they would dump the sewage in. Okay, if you're smart, that's the way you did it. All right? Now, that was a wonderful thing. All right, here's a little bit more technology. See, right here, you got right about right there, you've got Minneapolis. All right? right next to it. I'm shaking away here, too much coffee today. At any rate, in Minneapolis, at about 45th Avenue North in the Mississippi River, it would take in water, send it out to the homes and businesses. Those underground pipes would then put it in at the south end of Minneapolis. It was better for the people of Minneapolis, not so good for the people in St. Paul because they were a mile or two downriver. So they were taking it in there for drinking water. But Minneapolis wasn't off the hook because right up about here, you've got St. Cloud. All right? That's a big city. Those people are doing the same thing. And all these towns and cities going further up the line, they're all taking water out, but they're dumping it in. The further downstream you got, the more contaminated it was. In 1916 in Minneapolis, the rates of cholera, typhoid, diphtheria were right through the roof. And in 1916, the city said, you know, maybe we shouldn't just be taking it out of the river and sending it out to people. Maybe we should treat it. So when they took the water out, they started cleaning it. They used chlorine and products like that. By 1917, just 1 year after they started this, the disease rates and deaths dropped by over 90% in just 1 year. So it kind of shows you what it does. As the suburbs grew, they needed a couple of things. One is they needed water. And the second thing was they needed a place to put it. They needed a place to flush it. Now, the way suburbs dealt with water was a little different. Like today, Minneapolis, Minnesota takes 57 million gallons of water out of the Mississippi every day. They treat it, send it out to the homes and businesses, they send it to a sewage treatment facility, and it gets dumped back in the Mississippi River. So for every 57 million gallons they take out, they're putting approximately 50 million gallons back in. However, when you get to these outer ring suburbs, which are now cities, they do it a little different. Brooklyn Park, Minnesota is the fourth largest city in the state. It's on the north side of Minneapolis. All right, that's where a lot of people live there and drive to Minneapolis. It's only about 10 miles away. They're right on the Mississippi River. However, there's a little problem there. Surface water is expensive. You have to treat it. You can't just drink it straight out of the river. You got to treat it. That's an expense. So what Brooklyn Park has done, they've drilled 17 high-capacity municipal wells down in the Prairie du Chien Jordan Aquifer. Every day, they take over 3 million gallons of water out of that aquifer to send it out to the people. And it doesn't need to be treated. You know, a lot of the cities, they'll do water softening. And that's to protect their equipment. Not to protect the users, but more for the pipes and all that. So they may soften it, but they don't have to treat it to remove parasites and viruses, and that's what gets expensive. So here they've got these 17 municipal wells pulling over 3 million gallons of water out of the ground every day, send it out to the homes and businesses, in turn send it back to the Brooklyn Park Sewage Treatment Facility, but guess where it goes? Into the Mississippi River. Very good. See where it kind of gets screwed up there, where things kind of get derailed? Minneapolis takes it out of the river but puts it back. The suburbs take it out of the ground but put it in the river. And that's where our aquifers are starting to fall so rapidly. All right? Now here's how on-site systems, typical septic systems, have evolved over the years. Now back in the old days, of course, and some of you will remember this, outhouses. All right. When you built a house in an area and you weren't served by water or sewer, you needed two things. You needed a source of water. And back in those days, you hand dug a well. You went down 10, 15, 20, 30 feet. And you used a bucket to pull it up. You also needed a place to go to the bathroom. All right. Well, nobody wanted to walk a quarter of a mile in a raging snowstorm in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom. So you kept that close to the house, too. And of course, you didn't want it filling up right away and having to re-dig a new one, so you dug it pretty deep. The problem is, and you can see how it's working here, it goes down into that underground, that shallow water table, and gets pulled back up into the house. That's not what we mean by recycling. Okay? All right. Then we ended up with indoor plumbing. That was a big major change because, see, up to this point, you wanted water, you went out to the well and brought it in by the bucket load. Well, now all you had to do was turn a tap. Now you were using water by the barrel load, all right? Plus, a gentleman by the name of Thomas Crapper invented what? There you go. And that's the truth, although there is some disagreement on whether he was the first one to do it or not, but yeah, he's the guy to end up with his name on the crapper. However, you know, now instead of having a, you know, couple of buckets of water that you're dumping out every day, now you've got barrels of water, and you can't just dump that out. So what did people do? They just ran a line out to a ditch or a river, a stream, a lake. That was it. And remember those old hand-dug wells? They're still out there. So now it's actually going down there and getting sucked back into the house. Again, not proper recycling. And that was a pretty common situation. All right, and plus it's got a lot of far-reaching effects. Now watch how this goes here. Human waste is what? Manure. Manure is what? Plant food. What happens when you put plant food into a body of water? You get algae blooms and you get weed growth. That's what happens to lakes. In the 1940s with suburban living, what became real common is cesspools. Now a cesspool, and a lot of you have heard of that, all right? A cesspool is nothing more than a pit you dig. They usually dig them 10, 15, 20, 30 feet deep. You don't pour a floor. There's no concrete on the floor. You just take blocks and stack them up. You don't use any mortar. All right? You just stack them up higher and higher and higher. Then you run your sewer main in for your 4-inch main from the house, put a concrete cover, or sometimes they'd use wood, on top of that. Then you cover it up with topsoil, and that's it. All right? The problem is, you've dug that down so deep that you're actually putting it into the underground water supplies, because in most areas of this country, you can dig down anywhere from a couple of feet to 20, 30 feet, and you will hit that underground water supply. Those are shallow water tables. They fluctuate. Spring, summer, they're high. They go low in the fall and the winter and come back. All right? And some of you probably had to deal with those. But this is what was going on. Developers loved them because they're only about 8 to 10 feet in diameter, a very small footprint. So they loved it. They could just shoehorn in these houses left and right, and there's your cesspool. Everything's good. All right? But that's why now cesspools are illegal in almost every state in the union. And quite frequently with older homes, when the first one failed, because eventually it would get all scummed up on the inside, nothing to drain out anymore, what would they do? Just dig another one. So to go through the first one, then when that would overflow, it would go to the second one, and once again, you're having this problem here. All right? And in fact, I've known people that have found, well, there was a lady, we did a news story on CBS, as a matter of fact, on it. There was a lady in New Jersey. They had moved into this house. They hadn't been there all that long, but her and her two or three-year-old twins, they're out in the backyard playing, and all of a sudden, the little one, James, the boy, is gone, and she's like, where did he go running off to? And she started hearing this crying. She's like, what? She runs over, and here's a little hole, and here's the poor kid down about 8 feet. Well, about 6 feet, I guess, because she did end up getting him out. They called, and the lady actually called me up and said, you know, nobody told me about this. And I said, well, you better get a contractor out there and find out if there's any more. They found two more of these on her property. And you know what? She was hooked up to the city sewer system. Every year, you'll get two, three, four, five people that will fall into either a septic tank that isn't done right or an old cesspool, and they'll die. There's a lot of people that fall in and get out, but you don't hear about those. But oh yeah, it's not a nice way to go. All right, then you got the modern septic system, and actually a lot of this research was done in Minnesota, and it's not because Minnesota likes to think that, you know, oh, we care about water more. No, it's about money. See, those 10,000 lakes, they bring in a lot of cash. Tourism is very big. We take it for granted, you know, all the lakes when you live there. But people actually come from all over the world to fish and swim in our lakes. Well, in the 1960s, tourism started dropping off. And, of course, you know, business started dropping off, and they were complaining, you know, well, what's going on here? So they started calling up these people and asking them, hey, you've been coming to Lake Wobegon Resort for the last 30 years. Now all of a sudden you stop. You know, what's the problem? Well, your lakes are getting all green and scummy. The last 2 years we were there, the kids got sick after swimming in the lake. Now we go over to Wisconsin. They got clean water there. Plus they sell beer on Sundays. So, real good incentive for them. And of course, Minnesota said, well, we can't be losing out to the cheeseheads. We got to figure this out. So that's where Minnesota really kind of, you know, put their shoulder to it to figure it out. And that's where they realized when you got these cesspools next to a body of water, that's why our lakes are getting all green and scummy. So what they ended up doing is they came up with today's modern septic system. They realized, and it wasn't just Minnesota, a lot of other states, Indiana's good, there's a lot of other states that have done a lot of work, but I'm more familiar with what's happened in Minnesota, and Minnesota does a lot of work, education around, you know, for contractors, you know, government agencies around the country. But what they realized, okay, we can't go deep, let's go shallow, all right? And they found out something rather unique. In topsoil, there's bacteria. And what those bacteria are there for a purpose. See, Mother Nature had to come up with a way to clean up after animals. So what she did is she put bacteria in that topsoil. You pick up a tablespoon of soil from your backyard, there's over 5 million bacteria in that one tablespoon of soil. What do they eat? The stuff that's coming out of your septic system. They eat the parasites and viruses. That's their food source. Well, they realized that, hey, well, you know, that's kind of cool. You know, that's kind of decent. Now we're not doing this direct or non-point pollution anymore. You know, so we'll just do with these lines here. But the lines started plugging up right away, and that's where they came up with, well, hey, we'll put a septic tank in first. That, all the water from the house will go in there first. The solids will separate and store in the tank. The liquid goes out to this drain field unit here where it evaporates up and migrates down. They're like, wow, okay, we got it figured out. All right, now from there, see, not every site is conducive to a, you know, to a, just a regular gravity-fed septic system. In some cases, you have to go with an alternative style system. Mounds, a lot of people have heard of mounds. They're called sand mounds, turkey mounds, Wisconsin mounds. But that's where what you need, in fact, here I'll give you a little tidbit for you. If you built a box a foot by 2 feet tall, filled it up with sand, you could take 5 gallons of human excrement, pour it in the top, and by the time it came out the bottom, it would be clean enough to drink. All right? And it's not just mechanical filtration, there's biological action from those bacteria that are in there. So that's what removes all that stuff, all right? Well, you need, and in most states they agree, you need 3 feet of separation from the bottom of your drain field trench to your seasonal high water table. That will ensure that you're getting the treatment done. All right. While not every site is conducive to that, in some cases you're going to have a high water table. In a case like that, you bring in soil, and you build up. And I forgot to mention here. Let me back up just a second here. All right. With the septic system, you know, a lot of people think, oh, well, yeah, the treatment takes place in the tank. Well, no, it doesn't take place in the tank. It starts in the tank, but where it really happens is in the drain field and below the drain field. That soil underneath the drain field is what does, and the sides of it, is what does the majority of the treatment. All right? Well, if for some reason, high water table, whatever, you can't do it, well, then you go with like a mound system, bring in soil, build it up so that you can get that separation. If they also work good, if you have tight soils, like heavy clay, that won't perk, All right, and a lot of you have heard of that. What's the perk rate of a soil? It's how fast soil water will go through soil. Well, if you've got the real tight clay, the water's not going to go through it very well. So you're going to put out water faster from your house than the soil can take it. And that's where you would use a mound. There are other types of systems called ATUs, or advanced treatment units. That's where the wastewater goes in to the septic tank, then it goes into a second tank or a second chamber. And most of them are set up to be an aerobic system. And some of you have heard of aerobic systems. That's where basically you're pumping in air, and there's a few different processes to do it. But when you put oxygen in there, and you put in the proper process for it to go through, those nasty things will get caught in there and get killed. Then you can go out to a reduced size drain field if you're using the right kind. That, and well, I'll just give you an example of how you can judge, you know, contaminated water going through soils versus clean water. Go out in your yard, dig a little hole, all right, and then fill it up with regular water. Just fill it up as quick and watch how long it takes to go out. Now, go into your house, pour in some grease and some oil and a few other things and that. Now go out and pour it in that hole and watch how long it takes for it to migrate out of there. It takes a long time. That's why clear water will migrate through soils a lot faster than dirty water, okay? So, and these are going to be actually the route to go here. But see, the whole thing here is most of us, you know, when we think about it, we're here to discuss disposing of your wastewater, right? Wrong. See, when you dispose of something, that means you're never going to use it again. Proper term for that is called garbage. Water, you're always going to use again. If you don't use it, your next door neighbor is going to use it. If your next door neighbor doesn't use it, your neighbor 10 miles away or 1,000 miles away is going to use it. But somebody's going to use that water again. That's why you don't dispose of it, you treat it. All right? That's what an on-site system does these days. That's the whole idea behind it. All right, now we're getting down to where the big pipe, as I like to call it, versus septic systems. Now there's advantages and disadvantages to both. All right? And you need to look at them all. You know, there's cases where you do need sewage treatment facilities. Okay, the advantages of large-scale treatment plants. Number one, they allow for dense packed development. Now, if that development is already there, it'll solve a problem. If they want to build more homes in there than they can use with the septic system, because the septic system takes up a little bit more room. So it's got some size limitations there. You can get more homes in there. The more homes you have, well, the more taxes come in. And some people think, well, you're against development, you're against, you know, progress and all that. No, I'm not against it, but, you know, just let's just think things through and do it smart. They also encourage industrial and commercial development. That means jobs. You know, when there's a sewage treatment facility there, you can get manufacturers to say, well, if it's already there, sure, I'll put my shop up over here. So that brings in jobs to the community. And you know, I hate to say it, but we all got to work. We all got to get paid for doing something. So they also do something else. They take the failure out of your backyard. I know some people that just live in fear that, oh, my septic system's going to fail any day now. And I mean, literally, I know people that do not flush toilet paper down the toilet. They have a paper bag right next to the toilet, and that's where it goes. And I'm like, why? Oh, I don't want my system to fail. Boy, that sounds good, isn't it? And that's carrying it way too far. But some people are so afraid of it. And that'll take the failure out of your yard. So, however, there's a lot of disadvantages that go with them. For number one, they allow for dense pack development. You know, maybe you don't want three or four houses in between you and your neighbor right now. Maybe you don't want somebody to buy up those small areas and build right there. You like having a little space. You might not like hearing your neighbors fight at night. You want to have a little separation. They also encourage industrial and commercial development. Well, maybe you don't want the lights of the 24-hour Walmart shining in your bedroom at night. All right? Maybe, you know, you've got your favorite Italian restaurant, Luigi's. All right, you've been going there for years. You love his food. Plus, he happens to be your neighbor. But as soon as that pipe comes in, guess what? There's a Domino's over here. There's an Olive Garden over here. And there's a Pizza Hut over there. All of a sudden, Luigi's is out of business. Maybe you don't want that. All right? They take the failure out of your yard, but all that failure is done, it just moves downstream. One, and I'm going to say this, I'm going to repeat this in a little bit here, but most people are under the impression that sewage treatment facilities do this wonderful, perfect job of treatment. That is wrong. Sewage treatment facilities reduce. They do not eliminate contaminants in wastewater. In some cases, they're looking for 80% reduction. That's what they're looking for. That still leaves 20% of the contaminants in that water that's being discharged back into a river that somebody's drinking somewhere, all right? They also encourage industrial waste. Now, of course, we know companies are supposed to follow the rules and not dump things down the drain that they're not supposed to. But guess what? It doesn't happen. I actually know some researchers, I won't say where, but they were dumping radioactive waste down the drain under the impression that that sewage treatment facility would take it out. Well, no, it doesn't. What? What's that? You're liking this, aren't you? Pardon me?
Hospitals are notorious.
Oh, yes, hospitals are very bad for it. Good point. Yes, the pharmaceuticals, you know, they'll kill a sewage treatment facility. They really will. Sewage treatment facilities are more of an industrial-style large septic system. That's really all it is. They're expensive. This is another problem. See, most people, when they get offered the pipe, they're told, well, it's only going to be $6,000 to hook up. What are you whining for? Well, that's it? Well, yeah. Oh, okay. They go ahead and say, all right, yeah, go ahead, run that pipe, hook me up. Yeah, it was $6,000 to hook up. That didn't include the cost to build the plant and to run those mains out and repave the roads. You know that it costs, on average, $17,000 a foot to run sewer mains? That ain't cheap. And somebody's paying for it. Guess who pays for it? You do, with your tax dollars. All right? Property and everything, all your other taxes, all right? So they are far more expensive than people realize. But they also do something else. They can help deplete your local water supplies because, like I said, with Brooklyn Park, White Bear Lake, all these areas, you know, you're still taking water out of the ground, but you're not putting it back. You're putting it into a river. People in Billings, Montana, guess where they're flushing their toilets to? The Gulf of Mexico. Denver, Colorado, the Gulf of Mexico. Parts of Indiana, the Gulf of Mexico, or Lake Michigan, which is still part of the ocean chain, believe it or not. All right? So they can contribute to that. That's one thing, you know, all this, all our water short, well, so the farmers are doing it all. Well, I'm afraid not. See, farmers, yes, farmers do use water, but they're not taking it out of the ground and putting it into a river and flushing it out to the ocean. They're putting it back on the ground. Let's stop blaming farmers for everything. Plus, there's another thing. We need to eat, don't we? You know, if you're going to keep blaming them for everything, well, chow is going to get really expensive then. So, but yes, they contribute to that. Let's see. The disadvantages of on-sites or septic systems. Number one, they need to be properly designed and installed. There is a study done by Purdue University that showed roughly 85% of the people in Indiana, your septic systems ain't making it because of your site and soil conditions. 85% of you have systems that are not proper because of the soil conditions that you have here, all right? That means you're going to have to upgrade. They also need to be used properly. A lot of people think that it's just flush and brush and forget. No, septic systems do have some limitations, but most of it is just common sense, and we'll get into that. They also need to be maintained. And that's another thing that people think, well, you know, my grandpa used to just throw a dead chicken in the tank. You know, that'd take care of everything. And that's one of my favorites, but we'll address that when we get a little further along here. So that's the disadvantages of on-site. They need to be a proper system, a proper treatment system. They need to be used properly, and that just means common sense on your part, figure out how the system works and use it right, and you need to maintain them. All right, the advantages of on-sites. They're more economical, not only to install and operate, but you know, just overall. Well, I tell you what, in most cases, a sewage treatment facility is going to cost you 3 to 10 to 15 times more than what a septic system would cost you. People get shocked when they find that out. That, what, you mean I could have put in a new septic system for $7,000 and instead I paid $48,000 to the city? Why didn't you tell me about this? Well, if you knew about it up front, you wouldn't have done it, would you? They're better treatment when they're properly designed. And in fact, a septic system today, when it's properly designed, will create zero pollution. Sewage treatment facilities, they can't do that. All right? They can last indefinitely. Most people will tell you that a septic system's only good for 20, 30 years. That's the way it used to be. Well, we found out what causes permanent failure, and that's when your soil gets plugged up with solids that do not break down. There are things that you can do to keep those solids out of there. Once you do that, because a drain field, a septic system, is actually a living organism, it'll just keep on regenerating itself. So if you use it right, it'll never fail. It encourages better water and chemical usage. Now, people that live on a sewage treatment facility really don't think twice about what they're pouring down the drain. Paint, paint thinner, used oil, antifreeze. But most people, when they're on a septic system, know that, oops, I can't do that. So it encourages you to get rid of it properly. Now, believe it or not, you could take, like, paint, pour it out on your yard, and it won't cause any problems. Put it down the drain, it does. UV light takes care of a lot of issues. All right? It discourages over or stupid development. All right, so you can control things a little better. They do less damage when they do fail. You know, think about this. You take 2,000 homes, put them on a sewage treatment facility. You got 2,000 homes on septic systems. All right, you watch those homes on septic systems. Every now and then, one of them's gonna fail. Why? Because the people didn't follow the rules. Well, that's easy to identify and tell them to. So you might end up with 2 or 3% over 20, 30 years, right? But when that sewage treatment facility fails, now you got 2,000 homes all on one big failing system. And it can go on for weeks before they get it fixed. They also recharge your local water supplies. Instead of flushing it down a river, you're keeping it local. That's the big one. All right? Now, a lot of people will ask, well, gee whiz, why did the city do this? Well, keep in mind now, running a city is a business. It's not a charity. It's not a let's try and break even this year. No, cities need to make a profit. All right? One of the things that they can do is, well, if we build a sewage treatment facility, we can get the fees for it and we can make a profit stream from there. It's a revenue stream. All right? They ain't treating your wastewater for free or to break even, you know. They're getting paid for it. So, and if you're running a city, a county, a state, a country, it's your responsibility to figure out ways to keep bringing in money so that you can keep on performing. That's one of the reasons why cities do it. So it's not just because they're evil or anything. No, this is their job. That's what they have to do. Now, in the 1970s, when all these suburbs were popping up, community's leaders found that, hey, if we build a sewage treatment facility, it's one of those situations, build it and they will come. So a lot of these cities, communities, built sewage treatment facilities and then started going, hey, Mr. Developer, hey, Mr. Manufacturer, look what we got here in the ground. Come on out, we're all set for you. They did that to encourage development, all right? Homes and businesses, the more you have, the more your tax dollars, the more your revenue. And again, it's a business running a city. All right, but now by the 1980s, a lot of it had gone to more greed than need. Engineering firms began aggressively selling their products and services. It used to be they'd sit back and wait for the phone to ring when Hooterville would call up and say, we need a sewage treatment facility. Oh, okay, we'll come out and design one for you. Well, now they realized, well, there's a lot of money in this, designing these. So they started getting very aggressive. They went out shopping for business. They use unethical tactics to sell it through. There's a community near you, near me, that I used to live in a few years back. A sewage treatment facility engineering firm went to the city council and said, we'd like to build you guys a sewage treatment facility. Let us do it. Well, the city council went to, and there's six of them, right? They went to the city engineer and asked, hey, they want to build a sewage treatment facility. Do we need it? No. No, we don't need it. We don't want it. And we can't have it. And he told them, point blank, we don't have a need for it. This isn't an old community with a lot of quarter-acre lots. No, these are all bigger lots. They've got perfectly good septic systems on them. You know, but it's also the fact that we can't afford it. This would be a $100+ million project, and we don't have the population and the tax revenue to support it. There's just no way we can do it. So no, we don't need it. The city council told the engineering firm over the next couple weeks later, said thanks, but no thanks. Well, over the next few months, every one of those city council members and their families went on Caribbean cruises, courtesy of the engineering firm. And guess what got voted in when they all got back from their cruises? Sewage treatment facility. And I'll tell you who I got that from. The city engineer that resigned in protest. He said it was so transparent, it was disgusting. These people that were elected by the citizens to take care of them, they sold them out for a $5,000 Caribbean cruise. So, but yeah, that's kind of what was happening with a lot of these. The engineering firms also like to discredit septic systems. They tell, oh, they're expensive. And I'll give you a story on another one of these. They also say they only last, you know, limited life term. They pollute, central sewer will have at least a 50-year life. Well, that's wrong. So the average lifespan of a sewage treatment facility is, I think, a max 17 years, then it needs to be totally rebuilt. That's why usually they build them side by side, so that one flames out, they can shut everything over to here and rebuild that one. So no, they're not, they don't tell you that. And in fact, they got very creative to start convincing people that, yeah, this is the clear ticket. They would underbid, and they would focus on just one segment of the cost, and of course, we don't pay attention. They would say, your hookup fee is only going to be $6,000. Oh, that's it? Yeah. Who bothers to ask, are there any other fees? Is there anything else we're going to have to pay for? Oh, well, yeah, there's a couple of costs. There's going to be about $25 million to build the plant itself. Then there's going to be about another $40 million to run the pipes out to the neighborhood. So, yeah, there will be a little bit more. And, in fact, here, Oak Island, North Carolina, they sold the citizens of Oak Island a sewage treatment facility for $67 million. What a deal, huh? And of course, a lot of that's going to be picked up in grants from the federal government. Well, right now, it's at, let's see, what was it here? $280 million. But they don't tell you how the expense. They don't tell you how it disrupts your life. I mean, there's two seasons in Minnesota, winter and road construction. All right, I would assume it's pretty similar here. You know, how would you like it if your roads were dug up for a couple of years? And that's pretty much what happens. All right, the long-term financial effects. All right? High dollar in, development in your area. Some bonehead builds $1 million house next to your $200,000 house. What happens to your property values? They go up. And guess what else goes up? Property taxes. So, oh yeah, now your house, well, we're going to tax you on $500,000. What do you mean? It was $200,000 last year. Yeah, but you got $1 million house next to you. You're wealthy. No, I'm not. Increase in population. Not everybody wants all that traffic and all that population. They increase in lake and road traffic. You know, if you live on a lake, it's not going to be fun. You think it's crowded now on the 4th of July? Wait till that population boom happens. You need more police, more fire. You need more schools. All right? How does that get paid for? Taxes. All right? Now, yes, there's more population, but if they're living in condos and townhouses, they don't pay taxes at the same rate that homeowners pay. I want to touch a little bit just on our aquifers. Have any of you ever heard of the Ogallala Aquifer? Okay, a few of you have. The Ogallala Aquifer is the largest aquifer, an underground source of water, in the world. It stretches all the way from Texas up to South Dakota. That's it. Of course, it's underneath Kansas and Nebraska and Missouri, the corn and wheat belt. All right? All these cities along there, of course, you know, they're getting groundwater and they're pumping it down the river. The Ogallala gets recharged, and this is where a lot of people don't realize this, and even the people with the cities, no one bothered to explain this. This is fairly recent information that we found out about our underground water supplies. And underground water supplies are not a big lake or a big river like a lot of people think they are. It's really wet soil. You'll have bands of clay and tight soils. Then you'll have sand and gravel, and that's where the water will collect. And that's where you stick a well down into, all right? It's not a big open area. Well, that water, like I said, it helps support the topsoil. And in places like Florida, you've got very fragile soil structure to start with, and it's fairly close to the surface. That's where you start getting all the sinkholes, all right? Now, the Ogallala is getting drained, it gets recharged about a half inch a year, all right? You know how much water they're taking out every year? 30 inches. So let's do the math here. It's dropping 29 and a half inches every year, over and over and over again. Figure it out. Sooner or later, it's going to dry up. And then what are you going to do? Where are we going to get our corn and wheat and soybeans when the water systems are gone, on those underground water supplies? All right? If you don't want the big pipe in your area, you can fight them. You need to do something, and that is you need to agree to make sure you've all got code-compliant systems. All right? If they do not meet current code, the codes that are on the books today, not from 30 years ago, but today, you need to upgrade them. At any rate, so you can't grandfather in a system. You do, it's your responsibility as a property owner to make sure that you have a proper system. Once you all have proper systems, you can go as a group to whatever entity it is and say, we don't have a need for it. You know, we've got proper systems because their argument is going to be pollution. All right? Well, you already took care of the pollution issue. So now you can tell them, we have no need for it. We have code compliance systems, and we're maintaining them. There's a deadline, you know, if you do want to upgrade, if you want to stay with your septic systems, there is a deadline. You can't just say, yeah, well, I'll take care of it 10 years down the road. No, you need to do it, and you need to do it within a reasonable time frame. All right? Now, and you need to work together. It can't just be, well, I'm going to upgrade my septic system, because that's not going to do you any good. You need at least 75 to 85% of the people in your community, at least. Once people learn about what it's going to cost, what the damage is going to be, most of them are going to get with the program with you. So that's where it's your job to get out and talk to your neighbors. Once you do have a proper system, learn about it. you know, what you should and should not be putting down the drain. Learn what causes a system to fail. You know, and there's different causes of septic system failure. One is hydraulic overloading, which is a fancy way of saying you're using too much water. A septic system should be designed to handle, at minimum, 150 gallons of water per day per bedroom. Not how many bathrooms are in the house. Doesn't make any difference how many bathrooms are in the house. How many bedrooms are there? You figure it out. Two people per bedroom. That's where you're figuring out about 150 gallons of water a day minimum. All right? So if you got a three-bedroom house, your septic system should be able to handle 450 gallons a day. Now, in most cases, you're not going to use that much. But it's there for that cush factor when you've got the relatives in for parties and, you know, the holidays and all that, all right? So that's just it. If you got to, well, figure it out this way. If you got a system that's 450 gallons a day max and you're putting 600 gallons of water down the drain, it's going to have a problem. I mean, that's just a given. All right, chemical killing is another one. People put too many chemicals down the drain. There are chemicals that are sold at any hardware store, like Drano, things like that. That shouldn't even be on the market. Have you ever seen a kid that got into a can of Drano? It's one of the most disgusting and heartbreaking things that you'll ever see in your life. I was at one of the courthouses, government centers, pulling some papers one time, and here I saw this little girl. She's, I don't know, she's probably four or five years old, and she's skipping around and had long blonde hair, and then she turned around and looked at me. Her whole bottom jaw was gone. And I mean, I literally started going weak in the knees. I just, oh, because she was just adorable from here up. But from here down, it was hideous. She had gotten into the Drano. Stuff like that shouldn't even be allowed on the shelf, but people use it. Another way that systems get chemically killed off. Anybody here ever take antibiotics?
Yeah.
Yeah, most people do. Antibiotics kill bacteria in your body. But guess what? Then you go to the bathroom. Now that antibiotic goes out to your septic system. If it's short-term antibiotics, not a problem. 5 to 14 days, even 21 days, no big deal. But if you're on long-term antibiotics, like if a family's got Lyme's disease, that could be like 6 months worth of antibiotics. Case like that, you need to work to prevent the damage, and I'll tell you how to do that. Then also, the permanent, those are ones that you can reverse that behavior, and the system will start working again. But then you have permanent failures, and that's where solids get out of the tank and go out and plug up the soil. That's what a permanent failure is. And you need to learn about that stuff. Now here we are back to the wonders of science again. You see, when you flush wastewater down the drain, it goes out to your septic tank. Now the purpose of the septic tank is to allow those solids to separate. The heavier solids, and you know what that is unless you're on a high fiber diet, sink to the bottom. The fats, oils, grease, and toilet paper float to the surface. All right. What's in the middle is a relatively clear layer zone called effluent. Now when you put 5 gallons in the inlet side, it pushes 5 gallons out the other side of the tank, and you have a baffle system there. That's what prevents this floating scum layer from going out to your drain field, because you've got that baffle. Now that 5 gallons goes out to your drain field, where it percolates down through the soil, and some of it evaporates up, all right? So simple, sweet and simple. Now, when you do have a septic tank, you want to have it pumped and inspected. Now, a lot of areas are starting to go to mandatory pumping every 2, 3, or 4 years, which is a good start, but it's not the right answer. It's not the best solution. The time to pump a tank. See, if you don't pump your tank, these solids finally reach a point to where there's no place for them to settle out anymore. Now you're pumping those solids right out to your drain field. The time to pump a tank is when your tank gets about 30% full, when your volume is about 30% of solids. That's when you want to pump it. The better thing to do is have a contractor come out and inspect your system. They have a tool called a sludge judge. They can stick it in the tank, pull it up, and they go, okay, you've got 6 inches of scum on the top, 2 inches of solids on the bottom. You don't need this tank pumped. See you next year. That's what you should do. And in fact, I negotiated a deal. I've been trying to get contractors to do this all over the country. They think it's a great idea. The cities, the counties, they all think it's a great idea, but none of them have done it. I did it in my own neighborhood. I went door to door and explained to my neighbors that if our community makes, in our city, makes pumping mandatory, it's going to double or triple the cost to pump our tanks. And if you don't believe me, my cousin lives over in Andover, about 15 miles away from me. Everybody on their street used to have the tanks pumped every 2 years, $125. They just did it just for, you know, good preventive maintenance. That's why this, when the city said we're going to make it mandatory, nobody said anything. Okay, well, we do it anyhow. What's the big deal? As soon as it became a law, $300. Paperwork. Plus, now it has to be done. There's no negotiation. It needs to be. So you're either going to hire me or you're going to hire that guy. Right? And by the way, I don't pump tanks. So now when you do have the tank pumped, a lot of times contractors will come out and say, well, I can just go in through that little 4-inch or 6-inch pipe sticking up through the ground. Right? No. You have a manhole, or you should have a manhole cover on the top of your tank, and that's what they should go through. All right? And the reason is, first off, when they open up that tank, they're doing a visual inspection. They can, I mean, if they start seeing things like cigarette butts, feminine hygiene products, candy wrappers, those are things you're not supposed to be flushing down the drain in the first place. They can make a note of it. They can actually fish that out with a net. But then they also look, is this tank cooking? If a tank is dead because you're putting chemicals down the drain, they can tell, and they'll put that on their inspection. Then they can do the, you know, sludge judge it, and then they can tell you whether or not you need. But there's also something else. These baffles fall off occasionally, even concrete ones. Actually, the way this tank is set up with the PVC pipe, those are permanent. Those will never fall off. But most tanks, when they come with concrete baffles that are poured when they pour the tank, or they have plastic baffles that are riveted onto the side of the tank. Well, guess what? Concrete is not permanent. It'll get with those concrete baffles weigh about 80 pounds, and they'll get weak at the joint and fall off. When they're held on with stainless steel rivets, guess what? Stainless steel still corrodes, just at a lot slower pace than regular steel. So, but eventually it's going to fall off. All right? All right, now when a system fails, all right, you got your septic tank, of course, and your drain field. Well, when the solids build up out in your drain field, guess what happens? Water's got no place to go except up. So that's where it starts coming in, flowing down into your, you know, into your yard, into your neighbor's yard. There are products out there that you can get. One of them is an effluent filter. These go in, you put in the, you put it in, it takes the place of the exit baffle. It's a coarse grain filter. I actually took that one out of my tank on the trip just before I left for out here. I washed it good though. Actually, it's never seen the inside of a tank, don't worry about it. Those take the place of the exit baffle. Anything going out of your tank has to go through that. All right? Take a look at the holes on it. They're fairly large. The reason is effluent coming out of a tank is not crystal clear. If you made it real fine, it would plug up every 2, 3, 4, 5 days. All right? So it has to be fairly large. It's primarily for things that you're not supposed to be flushing down the drain in the first place. Cigarette butts. Feminine hygiene products, paper towels, things like that, baby butt wipes. All right? Those are the things that they're primarily meant to trap. Something else that does a lot of damage, and this is the one that really kind of shows the long term. If you want long term performance, a typical washing machine discharges enough lint every year to recarpet a living room floor. And I'll start over here with this one. Lint is not what everyone thinks it is. Big long strings that get caught on the pantyhose that you use, or those lint screens that you buy from the grocery store. You take a look at those lint screens, you could throw a cat through those, claws and all. Lint is actually very fine particulate, and most of our clothing nowadays is manufactured with what? Polyester and nylon. Synthetic materials do not break down in plastic. There is washing machine filters available that you can get and put on your septic or put on your washing machine, and that cancels out that problem. Actually, if I've done postmortems on septic systems, and that's exactly what you start seeing—the stuff in that in those bags—that's what you find out in the drain field. And even systems that have got effluent filters, it still gets through there. So, all right. Another thing that you can do is enter into an annual inspection agreement with your contractor for a reduced fee. He'll come out and inspect once a year as opposed to just automatically pumping. Now, I was telling you about in my neighborhood, I can't get contractors to do that. I've been trying to get contractors to do it. They haven't done it, so I went door to door and talked to all my neighbors. I said, if ORAC says mandatory pumping, our cost of pump is going to double or triple, all right? Of course, people don't want that. The other thing is the sewer main from the city of Zimmerman, 20 years ago when I first moved out there, it was 3 miles away. Today, it is 3/4 of a mile away. It just keeps coming out a little further and a little further and a little further. So I said, if they run that pipe, just running that pipe past our houses, we're looking at $20,000 to $30,000 just to run the pipe past our house. And of course, they didn't want that. And they said, how can we stop it? I said, if we all have code compliant systems and we're maintaining them, we can tell them no mandatory pumping regulations, don't need it, we're already taking care of it. And no sewer main, you're not running it up our street. For more answers on inspections, pumping, upgrading, filters, all that, you can go to your local or call your local health department or your septic contractor. I'm going to give some defense to contractors and health department officials. Health department officials, a lot of times people see them as the enemy. So they treat you as the enemy. All right? Homeowners start it, and it just keeps going back and forth. They actually want to help you. That's their job. So if you go to them nice and say, hey, I've got some questions, can you help me? They'll be glad to. Same thing with your contractors. Now, a lot of contractors don't bend over backwards to help people because for years they've been telling people about effluent filters and washing machine filters. And what has been the common response? You just want to sell me something. Get off my property. That's what it's been. So they really don't bend over backwards. But if you call them and ask them, yeah, they'll help you. Indiana Freedoms. There's another one. And I want to show you something here. You can call me, you can go to septicprotector.com, but I'm going to show you something here. This video, we used this in an educational video that we did for the University of Minnesota. In fact, I found it. It was 9 miles down the road from my house. Now take a look at that neighborhood. That's a nice any town neighborhood, right? You know, manicured lawns, puppies, kids playing in the yard. Take a look at this, right in the front yard. Oh yeah, yeah, and that's exactly what it looks like.
Looks like somebody ran over it.
Well, what happened, you see nobody on that street. On the south side of that block, they got the pipe. On the north side of the block, they've all got septic systems. So, and they've all got failing septic systems, and none of them want, well, if I replace my system, then they're going to, you know, I'll do it this year, and then they're going to run the pipe up to me. So they're all living with systems like that. But did you see, what do dogs like to do when they find something that stinks?
They roll in it.
Oh, yeah, and then they come home, hey, check me out, Dad, what do you think? You know, and you pet that animal, now you've got it, all right? But those, so there's common sense to it and safety. At any rate, I hope that gives you a little bit of more information about your septic systems. Thank you very much.